See? Ready? Oh, shit. God damn it.
I was a teenage anarchist looking for revolution. I had the style, I had the ambition. Read all the authors, I knew the Russogans. There was a war, but the class war. I was ready to set the world on fire. I was a teenage anarchist looking for revolution.
You can take a garbage can and throw it through a car window, and someone will say, "What the hell are you doing?" You know, it's punk. You can do any fucked up thing you want to and just say, "I'm punk."
It's just that kind of willfulness with a bit of insanity thrown in, a whole ton of fuck you.
Going against the grain when everyone else tells you no, that's punk rock.
Punk rock was supposed to be about no responsibility, no rules, I'm gonna do things my way.
In your face.
We're at the wheel turn an hour before social distortion is gonna go on, and Betsy calls me, my wife, she goes, "My water broke, I'm having a baby." And I'm just like, oh God, I don't know what to do.
You're gonna be the proud father of a little girl. I remember at that point, it was like everything went silent.
Some of the guys were like, "Good, you're gonna have a kid."
Having a baby changed everything.
You hear that, you hear that. And it totally did. Wait, don't hit him with a stick, please. Thank you.
I was on the street from a real young age. I was headed for trouble.
Our dads weren't there, man, and so fuck you.
There's nothing really in the punk rock ethos that prepares you for being a dad.
This picture was taken on the day we got to Hawaii. And I was playing in Washington, D.C. It was my birthday. And I flew home and got in at midnight and then woke up the next morning and got my kids and packed them up and got on a plane and went to Hawaii. And then we got there, and that was like the first day of vacation after I had been gone for like 3 weeks. So it was like, yay, everyone's back and it's normal time with Dad around again. Are you giving me a Barbie doll to take with me on the road? I don't think she'd be very happy on the road. She might get in trouble on the tour bus. I've been doing this for 20 years, being a singer for a punk band. Rock Belt, that's where the magic happens. I'm not even sure if these are clean. I just found these, but you know.
Can we get you a different pair?
We have a big album coming out. You know, a lot of touring in front of us. You got open house at school, I'll be in Myrtle Beach. Got a birthday party, I'll be in West Palm Beach. My anniversary, I'll be in St. Petersburg. Sometimes I'll be here, sometimes I'll be gone.
No, I can't take 20 Barbies. I'll take one collection.
For the first time, my oldest daughter said, "I hate it when you leave. You know, I really don't like it." It's heartbreaking.
20 years on, Pennywise is still rocking with a new album coming out. And of course, Reason to Believe is what that's called. You're leaving right after the Key Club show. Aren't you heading to Japan and then down to Australia? And you're gonna do it all.
This is the ever important shave kit. Everything in there, everything I need to keep moving on the road. Antacids, super important because you eat like shit.
Pennywise is like one of the pillars of punk. And certainly in the punk of my generation. They are a band that really stayed the course for so many years.
Shake hands all day, gotta get hand sanitizer. The hair dye, gotta keep the dream alive. Keep people thinking that I'm 20 when I'm twice that age.
Pennywise took us on our first Australian tour ever. Right then, Pennywise was breaking in Australia, huge in Australia, and Blink was nobody back then. They were like mentors to us.
Trimmer, because now you're starting to get hairs in weird places. A bunch of hats to hide the receda. Receding hairline has to be hidden from view. That's okay, you guys, I got it. My first two daughters named tattooed, but I don't have the third yet. It's taken a long time, and now they're kind of fighting over who gets Kate's name on their side.
Get a rose right there, Dad. It'll look cool. Plus, you know, my middle name kind of matches.
You're a rose.
And what am I?
I could make you a rhinoceros. What do you want?
I don't know.
Armadillo?
No.
No.
Unicorn? A
unicorn.
Butterfly.
Unicorn, I don't know. I think those tattoos have kind of gone out of style. You want to be a butterfly? These are all very girly tattoos. You got to remember I am a dude. So.
But I don't wanna...
All right, we have to go. We're going to be late for this thing anyways.
Bye.
Okay. Love you, girls. Everyone go to bed. Homework, bath, bed.
American Idol.
American Idol, bath, bed. Okay, love you. I told her this morning, I go, Kate, I'm getting your name tattooed tonight. And she was so excited. I think she even wanted to share it at school today during her share thing. Other kids are sharing like their dolls, and mine's sharing that her dad's getting her name tattooed. I think a lot of the guys in the scene are feeling the same way. Before, I think when we were younger, we were all very nihilistic and didn't care. Live for today, live fast, you know, do whatever you want. I don't think any of these guys expected to be around this long. Beautiful. Baby Kate, stoked. We grew up during a different time. We were kind of left to our own devices.
I didn't have a male role model. Male role models in my life were my dad, who left, right? Didn't pay child support, didn't own up to his responsibilities.
I used to have to salute him. Jack Grisham reporting for inspection, sir, when he got home.
My dad once told me if I ever get my ears pierced, he'd yank them out.
My dad hated me. He hated me.
I don't know what it is, but your thinking changes. You're that guy, a tie just grew out of your neck, and you become Ward Cleaver, and Ward Cleaver's a prick.
You march right back upstairs, young man, and put on a clean shirt.
All right, homie, I think we're gonna get ready and go to dinner. You got your stuff? I was doing my chores, and I was washing my dad's truck, and I was listening to a Descendants song, and he walked out. It was a song called Parents, and the hook of the song is parents, why won't they shut up? Parents, they're so effed up. And he walked out right when that was playing. Didn't like that song. And I remember he ejected the cassette and took it and threw it in the bucket of water that I was washing his car with.
Shit, piss, fuck, cunt, cocksucker, motherfucker, tits, fuck, turd, and twat. Shit, piss, fuck, cunt, cocksucker, motherfucker, tits, fuck, turd, and twat.
I mean, punk rock in general is really nihilistic. It was just about doing whatever you want, and usually whatever you want meant causing a lot of trouble and doing everything that your parents didn't want you to do.
Thank you. Thank you so very, very much.
How did we go from rebelling against our own parents to become parents ourselves? I just remember going out on the blacktop in kindergarten the first time and just having all those kids look at me like, there's something wrong with you, and like looking at me strange. And this one guy looked at me and said, oh yeah, you do that. You're like, you make that funny face and we'll go scare the girls. I was born totally cross-eyed. So to be like someone who's like with your regular face is scaring kids, it had a weird effect on me. From an early age, I started acting out and acting like a total freak just to have people look past my eye condition. And so right when I entered junior high and I was getting in trouble all the time, it was right then when this big musical bomb dropped on the cultural landscape and altered music forever. I was 12 years old in 1977. It was a really important time for me musically because that's really when music becomes a huge part of your life.
I started playing with Fear, I guess, in 1980 or 1981. Punk rock had already been going for like 3 or 4 years or something.
You have to be the perfect, stereotypical California teenager. And if that's not you, you better stand out in somewhere, else you're a loser. So like for me, it was like, well, I better find something. Thank God I got the guitar and started playing.
I think the LA scene, I think it was less about fashion than New York or London. LA's a funny city, you know? It's just like big, sprawling thing, and people get really lonely here. LA was more like these kind of like desolate people, kind of desperate people, all kind of coming together. It was a real feeling of bonding and a real feeling of community and a real feeling of belonging.
When it started, there weren't so many of us. So when you were driving down the street, if you saw somebody with purple or hair, you'd pull over and go, hey, what are you into, man? And it was that instant kinship, which was really cool.
It wasn't cool to be a punk rocker. Like, you walked down the street, people yelled at you, they made fun of you, they beat you up, they threw shit at you.
You can't look like you're fitting in to society if you don't want to fit in society.
I used to get beat up every day for having green hair. And it was a bunch of misfits who all came from the same kind of background, and you felt like you fit in finally. You were like, whoa, where the fuck did this come from? Why didn't I find this last year?
Here's this group of people that will definitely accept me no matter how screwed up I am. And you know, that was a feeling they couldn't get at home, they couldn't get anywhere else, and it was important to find that in life, or else you just feel cast out. I think in Hermosa Beach back then, it was a very strange place to grow up. Even though we're at the beach and everything's nice and it's clean and with everything we possibly want, the underbelly of it all is rotting. You have this huge military defense complex surrounding you. You know, you realize that your mom worked for Air Research and your dad worked for TRW, working on satellites. All these things you read about the paper are being built you know, two blocks from your house.
The attacks slashed at North Vietnam with renewed fury.
In our generation, our first images of politicians was President Nixon resigning.
I shall resign the presidency effective at noon tomorrow.
You had this spiraling divorce rate in the 70s, so a lot of broken homes, a lot of anger that couldn't be expressed anywhere else. It was supposed to be Ozzie and Harriet and the Nelson family and the perfect little family, but Vietnam and Nixon and all that came along and ruined it. It's almost like you're promised the American dream and you got the nightmare. But in reality, what can people do? You go throw rocks at windows, or do you? A lot of people decided to play music that sounded like a rock going through a window. It was like a powder keg ready to explode, and it did. In all of LA, a lot of really influential bands came from this area, but three of the biggest, Black Flag, Circle Jerks, and Descendants, came from one tiny town. And you'd see these guys walking around, but you'd also see their flyers, and they had these really, really aggressive, really dark flyers from Raymond Pettibone that were really subversive. A lot of them had pretty hardcore images on them that were against everything in society that we supposedly hold dear, religion, politics. I was part of the Black Flag fan club, and I remember bringing home Jealous Again, the Yellow album. That was the best music I'd ever heard in my life, but especially the voice. Ron had a very expressive voice. For me, even to this day, it's the most explosive, genuine, raw album. It was, I don't care what you think.
I don't care what you think. I don't care what you say.
That was exactly it. I don't care what you think. And I felt that way so deeply. Like, I don't care what you think. And to hear that just come right out of those speakers, it was just like, yeah.
No, 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 no values. No, 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 no values.
I rented a place in this place called The Church, and it became kind of the mecca for the South Bay punk rock scene that emerged in my living room.
When I was about 15-year-old, this guy hired me and my friend to work here. And it was across the street from the church. In fact, that's why I took the job. I really didn't want to work at all. It was huge for me. It was for like a little kid having Led Zeppelin living across the street.
So we kind of created this scene out of our like rehearsal space. Everybody was doing everything that you can imagine.
That's the one difference from the New York scene and the London scene that I saw a lot. I mean, yeah, they were violent there, but in California, it was super violent.
Black Flag always made me want to go out and drink beer and smash stuff up. Like, it scared me, but it also gave me, like, a boner at the same time, you know what I mean?
Just the troublemaking is what attracted me.
And I went to go see like Black Flag, and it was really violent, and people were getting beat up for having the wrong hair. And I mean beat up, not just like punched, I mean like hospitalized, and like constant. It was like ambulances just taking people away from shows all the time.
We had a lot of friends die along the way. Someone died of an overdose, a lot of psychological problems, so, you know, and obviously the bass player for our band died later on, and you know, you saw that happening all the time. So it was like, we knew the dangers were there. And that's what a lot of our songs became about, you know, is, you know, living every day like it's your last, because it could be.
It was angry, the lyrics spoke to me, the music was loud and abrasive and fast. The people that I went to school with hated it, they hated me, I hated them, it was perfect. It was beautiful. It was beautiful, it was everything I needed.
Oh,
thought we were going to change the world.
The whole thing boggles the mind. I don't know. You might say, hey, maybe punk rock was never meant to grow up, but it did, so too bad. You know, it's like, you know, we're in uncharted territory, you know.
Happy birthday, dear Brighton. Happy birthday to you.
Hey, don't get so excited, Brighton.
Let's see, Daddy. You can do it. You can do it. Hey! Yeah!
We are not men. We are Devo.
It's tough to be a punk rock hero and still be a good authority figure for your kid. It's almost impossible.
When my wife and I decided to have a kid, we made kind of a pact. Say, we're not going to change our life. We'll have a good time with the kid. We'll bring this child into our life. But we're not changing.
It pretty much changes everything.
I get up a lot earlier now.
I never thought about the universe, it made me feel small. Never thought about the problems of this planet at all. Global woman.
I'm tired.
I know you're tired. Because it's early. Go downstairs and watch some TV.
Okay, I'll be with you.
Can I carry you there? Yeah, I'll carry you there.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Why think all the bad things when life is so good? Why up with an M when there's always a could? Let the whales worry about the poisons in the sea. Outside of California, it's foreign policy. I don't want changes, I've no reactions. Your dilemmas are my distractions. That's the way to go, Franco, un-American. No way to go, Franco, un-American. No way to go, Franco, un-American. No way to go, Franco, un-American.
Gotta wait for the toast. There's no getting around that. Our drug use and our sexual perversities, you know, it's all out there for the public to see. The two dominatrixes on my arm, the one tied up with the ball gag, I don't know how to explain that to a four-year-old.
I think that when you're in a band, it extends your adolescence through the rest of your life.
The cool thing about what I do for a living is that the expectation of me as a father is so fucking low. I play in a band, and a punk rock band, and you know, people see videos and we're whatever, running around naked and we're cursing or whatever. The expectations of me as a parent is flat. The bar couldn't be any lower. Because I play in a band, people think that I'm just gonna be this, you know, I guess stumbling drunk to kindergarten graduation with a cigarette and a hooker.
This is my son, Keegan. He is almost 8. This is Spencer, he's 10. And this is Katie, who is 9 months old.
Oh, no!
Woo. Skaters themselves identified with the punk rock movement.
No!
do it yourself and doing things that are different that maybe the mainstream didn't accept as well. And it just was, I don't know, there was a synergy that was pretty obvious that most of the skaters identify with punk rock. Bye, Katie. Bye. It is hard to be home and to turn that element off. It's hard. It's the biggest challenge of my life, for sure.
Hot on your trail. I wonder what you're going to do there. I thought you were going to go fakie.
The wheels on the bus go round and round, round and round, round and round. The wheels on the bus go round and round all through the town.
I grew up in a family full of yellers, you know? So people screaming and chaos going on, I feel right at home in it. Whereas it makes my partners crazy. And I've really worked on myself with anger management to not be as much of a yeller. I try to save that for stage.
I got a little girl, Natalie, that is 21 months, and I got a son on the way, right when I get off tour. Oh! Oh, crap. Oh, crap. Oh, crap. You're okay. You're okay. You slipped out of my hand. You're all right. I know. You're okay. Look, oh, that really hurt you while you're smiling. Yeah, that was Daddy's mess up.
How'd you ever yell at the cat in the van? Jump on the fence, like, you little shit. Oh, I mean, shoot, shoot. Shoot.
The other day, I was driving my son and his friend, and they were in the car seats in the back. Jack turned to his friend and said, you know those bad words? His friend said, what do you mean? He said, well, words like hate and shit and fuck and fucking and fuck you and shut up. You're not supposed to say those things. And I just smiled, like, that's my kid. Like, it's all good. It never dawned on me that at one point I'd be a father and have to buy the clean version of my albums to play in the car. Yeah, that's a pickle.
Whoa. There's certain words that we try not to encourage her to be a part of her vocabulary. Those words will inevitably become a part of our vocabulary for sure, but in the interim, we can at least do our best to, you know, I don't know, put your finger in the dike and hope that it holds for a while.
How am I supposed to shelter the F word?
Okay, let's cross this way.
Wait, are we gonna turn
the corner? Yeah. No, we're going straight and then across.
Teaching my kids to do the right thing is incredibly difficult.
Hey, Brighton, what did I say? Okay, Kate, do you know how to use your brakes?
Yeah.
Okay, those are very important. Hey, Bright and Rose, what's that all about? Okay, well, I'm not sure if that was cool.
I don't want to be one of those guys where you're pointing the hose at the kids going, you know, get the hell off my yard. No way. I try to be a good dad. Fake seatbelt. Still a rebel.
How about this one? Pink one.
I don't see that pink one.
Oh, how about this one? This one's like cool hearts and skulls. Look. Hey. Yes, take my van. Cold.
listen to this. Oh, I farted. That's gonna be real stinky in here. That was a good one.
Oh, she's in a hoity-toity private school.
That's kinda hot. You can drop from there. Go.
I don't know, we hang out with her friend's parents and, you know, they're nice enough to us. They're just also boring, though. Wow.
Hey, wait up, man.
Like, really? That's your that's the story you're gonna tell me? That was it? Wow. That was your story. Boy.
Warning. See you later.
I went to volunteer at the school one time. I went up to the school for something and had no idea that I was wearing a shirt that said, fuck the police on it. Like, I was just that clueless.
That was embarrassing. That definitely was kind of like a, what are you doing, Dad? You're in the principal's office with the shirt with profanity.
One, two, three. One, two, three.
I remember one time I was in a ballet class. I was probably like 12 or 13. It was just, you know, we were like going through our class and one girl went to go to the bathroom or something. And she came back and she was like, Elizabeth, that was my teacher's name. She was like, Elizabeth, there's this really weird guy in the hall and really freaked out. And everyone looked out and, you know, my dad, I think he had a mohawk or something, was wearing like bondage pants. And everyone was like, oh my God, it's okay, just stay in there. And I looked and I was like, oh fuck, it's my dad.
You know, sometimes you think about like, you know, oh shit, should I have tattooed my forehead? You know?
Park. You better get there before they shut it down.
But, you know, that lasts about 2 seconds because to be honest, I am who I am. And hopefully I will instill in my son that you respect people on their merit, not on the way that they look. What's working is that I live in San Francisco. So you gotta basically be naked on fire before somebody's even gonna bat an eye at you. So, I mean, I'm stoked.
What are you doing?
And I'm pretty sure there's a lot more open-minded people here. It's not like I'm in Little Rock, Arkansas right now.
Hey, you guys wanna know how to clear out a park? Bring the punker. Yeah, bring a punker and the camera. Get this place to ourselves. High five, pal, high five. Let's go, come on, let's go down the slide.
Looking like this, trying to raise a kid. That might be a little tougher, you know?
Crazy.
You don't want to do anything that's going to inhibit your child's progression in life, because it's the most important thing in my life, is this kid now. I kind of choose not to take on, like, could have, would have, should have, or what will be, or whatever. I kind of just like trying to stay in the moment. And, you know, if I can win over her family, I can win over a fucking school teacher. You know what I mean? So.
He's eating a poo right in front of you. How does that taste, dog? Dude. This lady told me that any bad habits your dog has, it's actually your fault for not training him right. So when he lays a turd, you put some Tabasco on it. I can imagine my neighbor looking over and seeing me putting Tabasco on a turd and wondering what the hell I'm doing. Poops on. There you go. Try that on, Precise. See how you like that. Just the other day, I was talking to my kid, and I was saying something, and she looked at me and went like, and I could tell she had just turned off. You know, she wasn't listening to me anymore, and like was giving me like a, oh yeah, sure, Dad. And I, right in the middle, I go, don't like give me that look. That's, I invented that look.
If you wanna request a Pennywise song, you gotta add a fucking in there.
In the middle.
Like every single fucking day, or living for fucking today.
Peaceful fucking day.
Peaceful fucking day.
My own fucking country.
My own fucking way
of
life.
My own fucking way of life.
Wouldn't it be fucking nice
You got the fucking picture?
Penny fucking Wise.
Emma murmured her face to me.
Emma, I'm not gonna warn you again, honey. Okay? Then you're gonna stay home from Allison's.
It's like you're supposed to be a model citizen for your little kid and show him the right thing to do things, whereas, you know, I'm the exact opposite of that.
Fuck 'em all!
In the beginning, I probably let her do what she wanted, but now I discipline her, for sure. I never hit her, I never spank her, I pinch her.
Do you want one of these? Do you want one of these?
I just give her a little good pinch in her arm, and she goes, because I don't have the heart to smack her on her hands or her butt, but, like, I just figure I'll pinch her, and she'll get the point, you know?
Ready? Twinkle. Hey, I just turned that off. Hey, I'm turning it off, okay?
No.
You know this one, right? Sing the part that you know. You know how it goes? I'll start it. Now I'm standing on a
rooftop, way too far.
I think I'm at the
edge now,
but I could be
wrong.
Now I'm standing on a...
That's all I know.
That's all you know? The oven? We're not putting this in the oven. I've never microwaved peanut butter before. What if it explodes? I think mom and dad make the rules. I think that's how it goes, right?
Well, I'm in charge of my playhouses.
You're in charge of your playhouse?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
All my playhouses.
How many playhouses do you have? Are you a playhouse tycoon?
You mean, like, specifically, like, where I sleep?
Yeah.
Okay, well, this room is where I live, and this is a two-room apartment here, right? Yeah, this is a...
I can't rent a house because I owe the gas company money, I owe the electrical company money, I owe the telephone company money, so I can't rent a house under my name, so I might as well live in a fucking closet for $16 a month, you know?
I think what's happening is, like, with me, I'm noticing that actually I've turned a little bit more into my dad than I would have ever thought I would have. Let's go inside.
Oh, no.
Oh, no? What do you mean, oh, no? This is a great record. I wonder if they'd have the first Blondie record.
I would go for this one, Dirty Deeds. Because it's got my favorite AC/DC song on it.
It has my favorite.
Right on.
It has Rocker on it.
Okay, so there you go. Yeah.
This one has your dad on it. This was recorded in Hermosa Beach, where we used to live, where I used to live, of course. So, yeah, what a trip.
Me and Jessica McIntyre looked up you on Wikipedia, and we found a bunch of stuff.
That's hilarious. When Diane and I had kids, we tried hanging on to some of that, you know, going out, going to gigs, getting a little bit wasted, and coming back and, like, you know, trying to breastfeed and change diapers. And it just, it doesn't work. And God bless anybody who's made it work. But for us, it was like, this is not going to work. And I don't know if it was a conscious thing. We didn't sit down one day and say, hey, let's not be punk rockers anymore. But there was a definite switch in priorities as far as our life priorities. And it became more like, well, gosh, you know what? I actually have to pay for these diapers.
You get some kids, you realize they need to have their diapers changed, they need to go to the doctor, and you need health insurance, and then you need a house for them, and then you need clothes, and you have a mortgage. And then all of a sudden, the system that you are fighting against or trying to change, you become part of that system.
Everybody who has high ideals at some point has a crisis, you know, when they have to actually get food on the table and take care of other people.
No one joined Pennywise to make money. No one joined Rancid to make money. No one, we didn't start the Vandals to make money.
It kind of slowly became a job and what we did for a living. We're a working class band. It's not like we have Lear jets picking us up or, you know, manservants doing stuff for us.
Are you really supposed to make money from rock music? Do you deserve an income from rock music? Especially if you want to have kids too. Isn't rock music for the wild, rambling guy who maybe has kids he doesn't know about in each town and doesn't pay his taxes and has a drug problem and dies when he's 34, 35?
Your life goes through stages, and I don't think any of us, when we started punk rock, looked at punk rock as a career decision with a long-term career path and a pension plan.
It's funny in the punk scene because, you know, I've tried to always instill the Pennywises, the Bad Religions, the NoFXs, the bands that are starting to go on their 20, 25 years of existence, and it's not been that meteoric rise and fall of these bands. It's just been a steady, how do you make this a steady business?
Oh God, it's killing everybody.
Dude. How long do you think you can keep doing it and, you know, get supporting your kid and helping out?
I mean, as far as if you're gonna count on record sales, it's over, man. I mean, right now it is. I mean, there's no way we're gonna make any money on record sales.
For a long time, we stayed on an independent label, but it just, this last album, we just got to the point where that's not going to be viable for us anymore.
Everybody, it's Fletcher from Pennywise. I've been meaning to ask. The new record has been put out on MySpace for 2 weeks, right? Do you guys feel good about this new chapter in the Pennywise history?
I mean, yeah. Obviously, we've been on Epitaph for about 16 years or something like that. It's probably the greatest independent label in the world. Like a family to us, and just can't say anything but good things about Epitaph, but with the way the music industry's been over the last couple of years and people not buying records anymore and record stores closing, we just wanted to change it up a little bit.
I never judge them for it for 1 second, you know. I think a band, it's difficult to make a living as a musician, and a band's got to do what they got to do to get paid out there.
It's not even something I really put a lot of thought into. That entity is owned by a huge multinational conglomerate, which is probably the worst word you can mention in the punk arena. Just the other day, I went there for the first time for a meeting and walked into the lobby, and literally the hairs on my back stood up, and I just like, oh my God, I'm in the monster. I'm standing in the lobby of the monster, and there's Fox News on the wall.
Well, at this point, everything with meaning in this world better be prepared to be a brand. You know, I always joke, there's this place called Hot Topic at malls. I always call it the big church of the commodification of subculture, because it's where, like, every bizarre subculture can be friends at the mall. So you've got your, like, Sex Pistols baby tees, you've got your anarchist bracelets, your, like, little goth chokers, You know, your Tim Burton ephemera, your Slipknot, your Speed Metal, your Surfer, whatever. They're all friends. They're cheap. You know, this is corporate culture eating everything that exists up.
Let me take you to the hurting ground, where all good men are trampled down, just to settle a bet.
The Pennywise deal that we did, we worked with Pennywise to give their album away for free, and we found a sponsor to make sure that Pennywise was able to get paid for their art.
Now, what was the rationale behind giving it away?
We thought it would be a cool way to give back to the fans. We figured if we don't sell any records, then we'll be cool with just getting some new fans.
Some people compare the digital revolution, the web revolution, to the industrial revolution. It's really more significant than that. Stores are no longer necessary. Little shiny discs are no longer necessary. The trucks that ship the content back and forth are no longer necessary. The warehouses are no longer necessary. And probably the record companies themselves are no longer necessary.
I think for some reason, rock musicians are judged on a much stricter standard than anyone else in our society. I have no idea why. You make one wrong turn, they'd call you a sellout or something like that. You know, you sell an MP3 for 99 cents and they think you're ripping someone off, you know, where they have no problem, you know, paying $3.99 for a crappy coffee at Starbucks and it's not even a free trade product. You know, it's like exploiting some peasant in Nicaragua, do you know what I mean? And they'll just go down there and chug it, and then they'll fill up their car with Shell oil, right? And then they'll get mad at a band for being in a Nike commercial, having their music in a Nike commercial, when they're fucking wearing Nikes.
Forget punk, just ask yourself as a person, how is one supposed to operate ethically in this world while at the same time pay your way?
And the reality of having to make money and keep your family supported and then being home, there's this huge kind of sacrifice on both ends, the wife and the husband trying to figure out that balance.
What are we paying for? What are these checks for?
PE clothes, yearbook, planner, PTA membership, and foundation.
PE clothes, did I have to pay for PE clothes?
You know what? I mean, Pennywise, to make a living, have to work. And Pennywise work means getting up on stage and entertaining those who are willing to pay money to see them do so.
They just got to learn to kick ass live. That's what it's all about. You got to really know how to play music.
Well, now what you may have noticed is bands that, you know, would tour once a year are now coming home once a year.
I'm sorry I have to miss your thing tonight, but I want you to do really good, okay?
Okay.
Buckle up.
All my bags are packed and ready to go. I'm standing here outside the tower. I hate to wake you up.
Okay, everyone, be super good for mom while I'm gone, right? Then you have a good tour, and it's easier to keep going.
I love everything about Pennywise. Their sound, their aggression on stage, it's everything.
Pennywise is sick. Pennywise is great.
I just like the basic beat and like the singer, I like everything about it.
It's a sick, fast-paced punk band.
Explosiveness, like when they're singing on stage.
I mean, there's Black Flag, there's, you know, all kinds of good stuff. But Pennywise will always, always be in the top category of any punk rock bands. Period.
Right now, I feel happy about it. I understand that we're going out there to play music and do something for our fans, and I think we're still playing good music and stoking our fans out, which is what it's all about. As long as we're doing that, I'll keep doing it. Well, for a little while longer.
as long as they keep their live show as much fun and as good as it is, I think, you know, no reason they can't go another 10 or 20 years. Oh, kiss me and smile for me. Tell me that you'll wait for me. Hold me like you'll never let me. And let me go. Cause I'm leaving on a jet plane. Don't know when I'll be back again. Oh, babe, I hate to go. Well, just checked into my hotel in Austria, Bologna, Italy, Hamburg, Milan, Sardinia, Lindau, Germany.
8 o'clock in the morning, on a flight back to Milan. Vocals shot, as usual. Hey, where have you gone?
You used to be the one we looked up to. Perfect beat. Hi.
Have
you got a heart?
Hi.
Ship them off today. We mail them today, they'll make it there just in time.
In the end, it's all a question of hey.
Kids sense an intrinsic value to a live performance. It's something that they're part of. It's something that's only going to happen right then and there for that moment, and then it's gone. And so they put a value on it, and that's one of the places where artists can make money now. That's like maybe the main place for most bands. Touring is really something for people that are in their 20s to do anyhow. Who I am, who I was,
who I wanna be. The idea of touring at my age is hard work. I'm not in a band that's at a level that comfort is always there.
As the bands get older, you know, it's like, boy, this isn't for me. This, you know, I want a hotel, you know. They deserve it.
Or listen, get into the hotel right now, it's two, but I'm still trying.
Oh yeah, what's the hotel?
The Econo Lodge.
The Econo Lodge.
Every day convince myself of everything I can and can't believe. Abused, confused. Every day you get a little bit older and everything gets hard, you wonder why. Afraid, deranged. Hold on to your promise, you can use it for a crush.
It doesn't matter who the band is, it's all Spinal Tap. Everybody, no matter what you say, you know, you're playing the same kind of venues and you have the same kind of crews and the same kind of flights and the same kind of bad hotel food and bad hotel experiences.
Okay, let's see what we got here. We got a chicken sandwich, but the bread has like weird pimentos. Oh, man. What the hell is this? Look at this stuff. This is what I'm talking about. Like, what is that? I don't even know what that is. It looks like a huge flattened booger. I don't know what to do with that. Afraid, deranged. What do your promise? You can use it for a wish. Stand by while all your dreams get tumbled. This is the bunk area, where everyone sleeps. Usually when we're rolling down the road, there's anywhere from 10 to 12 guys sleeping in here at once. So it smells like a combination of ass, farts, feet, and a hint of balls in there too.
is sometimes. And I don't even know where he is right now.
I think he's going to lots of different places.
Yeah. Once he went to Texas.
Right now, I'm starting to realize, like, I don't want to do it this way anymore. You know, I don't want to sell the band out at every possible opportunity. I want to just play to our fans at the places that we want to play. I don't want to do a bunch of hype. I don't want to do all these things that people think you have to do to make a band successful.
Oh, fucking right, it's great to be here.
What happens to a lot of guys, you get up there and you're just sarcastic. Hey, Chicago, how you doing? Who gives a fuck?
All right.
What's going on today? How you feeling? And then you're like, I'm a dildo, you know? I'm not the real thing, you know? I'm just up here, you know, insert Milwaukee where Chicago was.
Oh, it's great to be here tonight. Have I said that yet?
You know, I'm just being honest. There's a lot of guys who won't tell you this. They'll go up there and be like, no, the show last night was rocking, you know, but they won't tell you they have hemorrhoids and their liver is falling apart because they had to drink, you know, a pint of whiskey to get into their personality for the show. And they're a freaking mess, you know. Or they're like me, they're on Ambien and, you know, hair dye.
Japan, I was so sick from the night before because everybody wanted to party with me. I started feeling nauseous in the van. I was like, oh my God, I feel nauseous, dude. I was like, I gotta puke. They opened up the fucking sliding door and the guy's rolling me down my bondage belt and I'm throwing up out the side of the freeway, dude. Like, Well, I saw Fletcher one time throw up in the crowd one time.
Yeah, that's great.
I saw him go, flies out of his mouth, dude. Pictures out. Pictures out like crazy of him. Throw up coming right out of his mouth while the guitar in his hand, dude.
He's an artist. He's a vomit artist.
When I'm on tour, I'm drunk every day, for sure. I will not play sober. And I'm not one of those guys that has a couple drinks before a show. You know, I will have 4 vodka drinks and maybe a Valium.
Yeah, look, let's just get this one thing straight. Michael Jackson, wow, he wrote some good songs, but he was a fucking child molester, so fuck him. This song, it's for Michael Jackson because this was actually the theme song of Neverland. Here we go, it's called Fuck the Kids. Fuck the kids, fuck the kids, fuck the kids, fuck yeah, yeah.
Every road guy to me is an actor. I mean, you have to make them think that this song you fucking hate now. You hate playing it. You don't even listen to it anymore. But you are playing it to this person. It fucking means the world to him. And you can't even believe you're singing this right in front of him. And it's his one night out and your 900th night out. You're looking at your watch. How you doing? I don't know, 3 days left.
My name is Randy with the Can I Am Handy. Watch what I can do. Fuck all of you.
If you're touring with your band, it's the pettiness of traveling on the road is ridiculous at times.
My name is Randy. I look like Jamie Foxx. If you ask me what I like, I'll tell you I like cocks.
Okay, here it is. My name is Fletcher, and I am real big. I cannot see my penis, but I sure can find a fork.
The other guys, I mean, especially Fletcher, man, he wants to just keep doing this forever, you know?
At least I don't have hemorrhoids. At least I don't come back from the bathroom fucking talking about, oh my God, that outhouse, Code Red. You don't want to see what happened in there.
Well, at least I don't pee in the sink.
Hey, the sink's perfect.
Fletcher pees in the sink.
Sink's perfect.
What do you think?
Yeah, big fucking deal. I'm fucking drunk again. God damn it.
couple of the other guys in the band don't have kids, and you know, they want to keep going. They want to go out there and rage and go out and party every night and play shows, and that's totally fine. That's great. If you don't have kids to consider, that's an easy decision.
When you're Jimmy from Pennywise and you're drawing anywhere from 1,500 to 5,000 kids, and that's anywhere, not in the state, country slash the world, and you've got three other people that are counting on you to keep it going, no longer are you just like, you're the singer. Like, you can't go, oh yeah, dude, Pennywise without Jimmy, that's cool. You know, it's like, no one can replace the singer. It doesn't work.
This band was fucking built on fucking backyard parties and fucking Budweiser, and we're never gonna stop until I have to give a liver transplant, and then I'm gonna fucking slow down for like a couple weeks.
Punk rock singers should be up there bleeding and drunk and
how we doing up there?
You know, off their tree every night. It's like, that's who they want you to be. You know, they want you to be the tragic figure of Darby Crash or Sid Vicious. And, you know, get on heroin and get drunk and play totally fucked up and, you know, break bottles over your head. Who wants to be that every day? You'll be dead by the time you're 30.
It's like, you know, you write a song when you're 18. Like, you know, fuck the world, I'm going to die before I get old. But then you get old and you don't want to die.
Dying the goatee a little bit. Getting a little gray, don't want to disappoint the kids. I don't think I'm getting old. So, a little hair dye on the old beard. Look young again. Don't tell anyone I'm doing it, though. I want the secret to get out.
We were going through the set for the next Blink tour that starts this summer, and there was a couple songs that got cut, because I'm like, look, I'm 37. I'm not singing about jerking off. Right now.
Yeah, sometimes you feel like a birthday clown. There's definitely that element in there. It's like, all right, you know, these are little kids and you're entertaining them. Why not make a balloon animal? You know, they'd probably like that too.
Live fast, die a little bit older.
I don't wear boots and go do random acts of nihilistic destruction, even though I thoroughly enjoyed doing so as a teenager, right? You know, I think that's probably the right time to be doing it. You know, if you do it at my age, you're a terrorist.
Here, let's play catch with that diaper behind your head. There's a dirty diaper. Throw it to me. Come on. Let's have some fun.
I've been touring a lot in the last 3 years with Nine Inch Nails. It's tough finding the balance, and I constantly work at that because I work a lot.
What do you think's in there? One or two? Throw it, we'll figure it out. You know, I think it's two, actually. Just go ahead, throw it to me. Whoa! I don't know. That's questionable. It's kind of heavy. Oh, gee, gotta catch it. This was his to begin with. Here, can you play catch? This is gonna be the most screwed up part of the whole thing, playing catch with a dirty diaper. As my oldest son gets older, it's getting hard, you know, the more he turns into his own person and the more he and I have this bond that continues to get stronger and stronger, and he's turning into a little boy. It's just tough being gone, and now we've got this newborn.
Go!
Go, Augie. It's the late night phone calls where he's sad or asks me when I'm gonna come home, and that's the worst part. The rate and the volume that Nine Inch Nails has been touring, and I just couldn't keep up with it right now. You know what I mean? Augie. You know, I left the band strictly because of that. Because I need to be around more. Yeah, there's the Wawa. No, we're not walking down to it though. We can look at it from across the street.
All right, we're running a little bit late, okay? So let's get going. All right, jack it off. Okay, let's get the jacket off. We'll go to the bathroom. My child is 5 years old. I've never been home for Halloween. You know, I've never seen her on Halloween day and we're seeing her trick-or-treating. You know, like, so there are things like that that sort of, that are sad moments that you miss, that you sacrifice.
That's the hard part for me is knowing that there's things I want to be present for.
Okay, go jump in the car.
I missed the first day of school for my kid this year to go to Europe and do extra shows that I
They didn't want to play, but the guys really wanted to do them and thought they're important.
I hope my kids understand one day that the reason I went on tour is so I can give them everything.
Is that considered? Oh, ballpoint pen. Okay, you got it. Should we go see if Brighton's coming up the street yet? It's only exactly 3 o'clock, so I'd be surprised if she made it home yet, but. So how was the first day, you guys? Was it fun? Did you guys have a good time?
Yeah.
Ready, get together. One, two. One more, one, two. Emma, stop it. Okay, one more. One, two.
Hello.
Hi, we can't see you.
Yes.
Hi, can you see me?
Daddy, look it, there he is. Hi.
I think so.
I am Bebo.
Yep, and Kelly was here and we went school Bebo. Shopping.
Oh, you went school shopping with
Kelly. Yeah, we went to go get supplies.
Uh-oh.
Where are you?
There you are.
How come you can't see us?
I don't know. I just had me, then I'm gone.
Uh-oh, get yourself back. It's not quite the same unless we can see you.
Daddy, let me tell you about my day. Are you ready?
Okay, how was it?
Hold on, Kate's trying to be in front of me, so I'm going to wait till...
Good confetti. Okay, go ahead.
Okay, Dad. All right, so do you want to hear about my whole entire actual live day?
Yeah, let's hear it.
Dad?
Growing up, my dad was a salesman and had to wine and dine clients, you know, after work, and he missed out on baseball games and stuff like that. I'll never forget this one game that I pitched, and I got, I pitched a two-hitter, and we won the game. After the game, I, you know, wanted my dad to be proud of me. I came out, and he showed up at the end of the game and missed it all. Even though I love my dad and stuff, I was like, how could you miss that and not be there for me? Like, that was such an important thing, and I wanted you to be proud of me. I won the game, and everyone cheered for me, and it's something, you know, even though it was a long time ago, it still sticks with me, and I don't want to do that to my kid, you know. It's like, I don't want him ever to be like, where were you?
When I had my daughter, that's when I started to really get angry at my dad. I never went to the park with my dad. I never went to a game with my dad. I never did anything with him. And I was asking him about it. He's like, yeah, your mom used to make me take you on weekends, you know, twice a month, but, you know, I didn't want you around. And he would be at the pool at his adults only apartment building, and I'd be inside watching TV.
I don't understand why they would let me just roam the streets as a kid. When I was growing up, came home from school, and, you know, when the street lights come on, it's time to come home. And so that's a solid, like, 3 or 4 hours where they just had no clue where I was or anything. That is wheels off. And they were just like, you know, drop us off at the park. All right, we'll come back in 2 hours. You guys have fun. And that was normal.
For the first 10 years of my life, I was raised from a single parent. My mom was a single parent.
My dad left when I was real young. I had a stepdad who had a lot of major substance abuse problems. My mom was a full-time worker and just didn't really have time and really know what I was doing, you know?
I once asked my dad what the difference between a Republican and a Democrat is, and his answer was, we're Republicans, son. So I don't know if that tells you.
I just was not happy with my family life. I just didn't like my whole thing. My mom was so overboard Christian, and my dad was a gun fanatic, and he trashed my place. He ripped off my posters and broke my records, and I ran away from home.
My parents divorced at 9, when I was 9, and so I had to be dad.
My father left when I was 4 or 5, and, you know, took that walk for the cigarettes and didn't come back.
So we ended up on the welfare thing, eating the welfare food, Velveeta, and the big cans and all that shit.
The police would come and knock on my window and sneak us out because my stepfather was in another part of the house with a gun, threatening to shoot everybody in the house.
but it's made me want to be a better dad. I try to catch myself when I see my dad coming through.
I learned something about my father and every other man that's walked out on their kids. I learned that there are some people in the world that don't deserve children, and that they really don't deserve them.
I mean, because my parents just didn't really do it. They weren't really present, and, you know, I don't think that they were really focused on the job at hand. You know, I don't think that they knew, you know. And I just, like, for me, like, I saw, like, this little girl that I loved so much. I wanted to be there for her at all times and to be there, you know, when she was really young. I was, like, I stopped doing everything. I stopped drugs. I stopped drinking. I stopped smoking weed. It was like, I'm going to be here for you, you know. And whether I'm on the other side of the world, when you talk to me on the phone, I'm going to be present, you know. And, like, that's what parents are supposed to do, you know. So I guess it's like I feel sad because I just feel like, you know, that my parents, you know, it's kind of sad to me because they just never understood that.
Father of mine, tell me where have you been? Just close my eyes, my whole world disappeared.
I just remember being a really sweet boy that wanted everybody to just behave. I wanted my daddy to be my daddy and my mama to be my mom. And when I was six, my dad split to Florida. He didn't pay child support.
Father of mine, take me back to the day. Yeah, when I was still your golden boy, back before you went away. I was 10 years old. Doing all that I could. Wasn't easy for me to be a scared white boy in a black neighborhood.
I was abused. I was sexually raped by older boys in the neighborhood. I was the only brother.
Never be same. I will never be sane. I will always be weird inside. I will always be lame.
One of the things of therapy I'm in right now, I'm dealing with a lot of the trauma that happened to me as a kid, is I go back as an adult and comfort me as a child.
Father of mine, tell me how do you sleep with the children you abandoned and the wife I saw you be?
When my daughter Anna was born, I remember she was born in the early afternoon. I remember sitting down on the couch in our apartment and feeling this weight, physical weight on me, like I had never felt. It just felt like an elephant was sitting on my chest. I have no idea how to do this. I can barely take care of myself.
I'm a grown man with a child of my own. I swear I'm not gonna let her know. All the pain I have known. Daddy gave me a name. Daddy gave me a name. Then he walked away. Daddy gave me a name. Then he walked away. Daddy gave me a name. Then he walked away.
Okay, I'm gonna go outside and work. You wanna work on the tomatoes? Plant that stuff?
I am.
Dari, you wanna help me? No? All right, come on, Nico, let's do it. You got the directions? Do you have the seeds? Let's do these over here. We're gonna test natural selection is what we're gonna do. And we'll have to pull out keep the stronger ones, because those are gonna be the ones that'll make the tomatoes. It's really hard to grow something from a seed. I'll be impressed if this actually happens. When Mary and I got married, we wanted to have children. It was like, that was in the plan.
and the pregnancy went really well. But then something went wrong, and she had a stillbirth. And I said, can I see the baby? Bring me the baby. They'd wrapped her up and sat, let me hold her and let me sit with her. And, you know, I talked to her and read her story and just tried to not lose my mind. So I can still see that baby. I can still see Annabella, you know, and I can still see her face. She looked just like her mother.
These kids need you, man. Cats in the Cradle is so real. You know, and that song, you know, promising the kid and we'll get together then, son. You know, we'll have a good time then. That's him when he's young. Him and his brother sleeping, when, you know, just stuff. That, a lot of stuff when I wasn't there, like what he was doing. Those were his shoes he was wearing, his last cup. This is his little thing when he was 9. That was him. He just got this, his first tattoo, Peter's. So all the nephews and brother and everybody's got, I even got one. Can you see it? Kid was coming down a street that was just about to get onto the freeway. This guy couldn't wait, and he went to make a left right in front of my son, and my son in front, instead of hitting him, tried to veered. He didn't go to the hospital, nothing. He was in the worst car crash the towing company had seen in 10 years. Car was split in two, wrapped around a pole. They had to take two trucks to. He was killed instantly. It was just a gnarly, it was like, where was he? It was so gnarly in this thing. My boy, I see your smile. Can feel you right beside me, my sweet child. I miss the games, I miss the school plays. A bomb. My first parental instinct when I heard my kid was killed. Got an answer, got a gun, running to the gun. Been there, half-assed suicide. Do I really want it, blah, blah, blah. Whoa, that's kind of gnarly. Blah, 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 this was the answer. My kid needs a jacket, warm, something to eat. You know what I mean? This is a gnarly trip. I gotta go find him before he gets too far away. And I was just running to go get my gun. I was almost happy, kind of. And it was not gonna be any hesitation. And in a matter of a second, my other two boys came up. And I got so fucking bombed, I collapsed. And totally seized up and shit. And because I couldn't go nowhere, you know, I can't go nowhere.
We've been through a lot. And this is the most important job a person can have, is that of a parent. And anybody who's lucky enough to have children needs to understand that. This has to be everything.
It's funny how you always hear about people saying, like, you know, that thing of the classic parent attitude of, like, to a kid, like, I brought you into this world, I gave you life, you know, you ever. It's like, I just think completely opposite. Like, my kids gave me life, you know, they gave me a reason.
To become a real parent, whether you're a father or a mother, you have to, there has to be this almost physiological change, definitely a psychological and spiritual change. There's a couple of kids in the back of that wagon. That baby in the back, that's mine. This is Arizona. The transition that I was talking about, I think once it happened for one child, it was kind of in for not just any other child I have, but for any child I ever see. I'm the kind of person that if a kid's running loose at the airport, I'll pick them up. Of course, I'm sure I freaked a lot of parents out. You know, where's my baby? Oh, that blonde man with the tattoos and the earrings is carrying her. Oh, that's cool. You know, that's kind of scary. But I think once they meet me and they see the way I hold a baby, they know that I'm a dad, because kids know that I'm a dad.
I want to be present for my children, mentally and physically, and being gone all the time just doesn't work into that. And being home for a day or two here and there really doesn't give you that bonding that you need.
Being a parent is such an indescribable thing that when you talk to people, friends who don't have kids and are maybe thinking about it, or maybe like a friend whose wife is pregnant, and they're like, oh man, it's coming, what's gonna happen? And you're like, I'm gonna tell you this, it's gonna change every single thing in your entire world. And I tell you that right now, but it'll be 10 times that when it actually happens. It just really is like, it's like red matter from Star Trek, you know? It just sucks everything in, and your whole world just becomes this right here. And it's the most amazing thing ever.
My family comes first, regardless of anything. And that's the beautiful thing about Rancid, is that, like, you know, me and Matt both have kids.
I'm real lucky because I've got, you know, guys that I work with. They're super involved and super, you know, I mean, they get it. You know, they understand. You know, and they love those kids too. So I've been really lucky with that. Yeah. Okay, give me your foot.
Thank you very much, girls.
You get to a certain point, you're like, you know, what have I done, and where am I going? And I think guys, girls, women, men, they end up going through it at this time. You start saying, do I like who I am? And do I want to continue being this person? What I'm getting at is that this is a midlife crisis, you know, spelled out in a band.
Throw a little Hallmark card.
Hi, Dad. Hey, kiddo, what are you doing? Practice your guitar every day?
Nope.
Every day?
Yeah.
Even today?
Yeah.
Yeah? Awesome, B. Yeah. I'm so proud of you.
Am I loud and clear? Or am I breaking up? You look out the window and you have a lot of time of thinking about your family and your kids getting older.
Then all of a sudden you found yourself, I mean, the years start going by quicker, and you need to find that how you get off the road.
I moved some dates around, so I'm flying home from Texas for the father-daughter dance. But the band doesn't know that. I'm sure when they find out why I switched the show, they're all gonna be pissed.
We live on front porches and swing life away. Get by just fine here on minimum wage.
My middle daughter has never had just me alone for the father-daughter dance. She's always had to share me with her older sister. And, you know, I have to go to the dance and dance with two of them at once.
Beautiful.
My middle daughter definitely likes his having just me and just my attention. So this is the 1 year that she will have that.
We live on front
porches and swing life away. We get by just fine here on minimum wage. If love is labor, I'll slave till the end. I won't cross these streets until you hold my hand.
Piss everyone off to make my daughter happy. The other day I get a 5-page letter from the band saying that I don't appreciate what we have and, you know, basically that I'm an asshole because I won't tour enough and won't tour as much as they want. You know, I feel like this year I've toured twice as much. Just looks like every other downtown city I've been in the last freaking month and a half. I added it up, we did like 115 shows this year. Definitely burn out from playing shows and just need a little break.
Fuck, I need a Red Bull.
This isn't something that it has a lot of precedent. If you're a big rock star, you know, it's no question you go on tour, you make millions of dollars. And then if you're a small band, you know, people know that you can't continue to do it past a certain age.
Do you have a list for Club Nokia?
When you're right in the middle like this, it's kind of difficult.
Last name Lindberg, L-I-N-D-B-E-R-G.
Nope.
Do you have Fletcher Draghi, Byron
Last name?
Lindberg.
First name?
James or Jim.
That's you?
Yeah.
That's your ID?
Yeah.
A lot of great fans, and we had a good time doing it. But I'm up there trying to be a good lead singer of a band and a good dad at the same time, and you start to worry if you're doing a bad job at both.
Oh, shit.
I have, you know, been in places where there's that fan and the adulation and stuff like that, and it's huge. And you know what? I got an ego just like anyone else, and I like that. It feels good, you know. But you know what, it's still, you know, you come home and, hey, Dad. I got a house full of teenagers, and they're still here, and they're not, and they haven't moved out. And, you know, to me, that's just the crown for me. I just love that. That's awesome.
Growing up here in Hermosa Beach, I learned from bands like Black Flag and the Circle Jerks and the Descendants. You don't have to kill yourself, you know, playing a different show every night for months and months and months. You do it as much as you can and still live your life and be happy.
We got one more song.
Before this song happens, I'm gonna invite fucking our band up here. This has never happened in the fucking history because it's kind of fucking gay, but we're doing a group hug up here, Randy. Get your ass over here. Byron, get your ass out here. Don't make me drag you from behind that kit.
What? Group hug.
What? Byron, come here.
Pennywise, motherfuckers, let's hear it for us.
This is a fucking family up here, motherfuckers. This shit don't happen.
I love you guys.
I love you guys.
You know, I guess it's a part of us, you know, getting to a certain age, but our drummer's mom passed away, and then Fletcher's brother passed away, and, you know, we had Jason. You know, we're all men. It's hard to sit there and pour your heart out to each other.
the ghost of the world without too long. Life is almost better than you can lose. When you were here before was ever in it. Never mean it was, I didn't get it.
We did something, it was great, and it was filled with all the drama of life, the tragedy, the success, the fun times, the not so fun times. It's time to just put the final chapter on it. Kind of made the decision, like in the last few hours, that I'm gonna tell the guys that I don't wanna do it anymore.
It's a crazy day, I quit Pennywise today. Yeah. It's official. I told Randy and Byron, but Fletcher won't answer my phone calls for the last 3 days.
I didn't want to be sitting in a hotel in Pittsburgh and missing the soccer game and the piano recital. And I didn't want to miss out on some important thing that I needed to be there for my kids, or miss some lessons that they needed to be taught that I wasn't there for. Now's a great opportunity to try different things with writing or other types of music or doing soundtrack stuff. But at the same time, I'm not above anything to take a regular job.
The statement came down on Friday. Let me read this and then we'll discuss. After 19 years with Pennywise, Jim Lindbergh has decided to step down as lead singer. And we wish Jim the best of luck in his new ventures, whatever they may be. But F him, it says here. I don't think I'm sorry, that was an ad lib.
He's got a family and he wants to
be... Well, he's a punk rock dad, for God's sakes. He wants to be more dad and less punk rock, it sounds like.
You said that. I didn't say that. I mean, like, we got to respect the fact that he wants to spend more time with his family and he doesn't want to tour as much.
You don't take risks and you don't gamble with your children. You can take risks for yourself. I don't think we have the right to take risks with our children.
There's one thing to be an individual, there's another thing to be an individual at the cost of the people around you.
I'm tired of watching my life go by like a fucking really fast movie. It's like a fucking bad Twilight Zone.
I'm raising my kid the way I wished I had been raised. I think that's what we're all doing. Someone said the other day to me, man, I wish you were my father. And I go, me too. I wish I was my father too.
I know there's kids out there that might be watching this or can relate or that are from broken homes and that you clung to that anger. But you learn over time, you learn to take the anger and make it something positive. You take a negative to positive, which is gonna put you on top, which is another whole type of level of a punk rock feeling, of like flipping the switch.
I just felt there was a better world out there, that with a little bit of unity and cooperation, we could all make this place better. And it's very idealistic. It's a very young person's way of looking at the world. But I think once you get older, you get a little more realistic. But that's what I want to have. That's what I want to hold on to, is that feeling that we can make a change out there. And maybe the way we change the world is by raising better kids and being more attentive to those kids. And maybe that's how we change the world. Instead of by writing a punk rock song, maybe we just be better parents. So I want to be around for my kids. I want to be there when they want me to be there, and I think that's the punkest thing of all.
Ah, ah, ah.
wants us to start a swear jar, but I think all the money's gonna go to her. So it's, you know, and so she'll call you out on it. You'll be like, damn it. She'll be like, daddy. I mean, crap. Crap is like a quarter. I'm like, crap is no. Crap's in the dictionary.
Does anybody really get offended by the word fuck? Anybody, really? I don't think so. But yet, when we're around people that we don't know that well, we don't say it. Let's bring down these walls between people. The word fuck can bring us together as humans.
Fuck the neighbors.
Why?
Well, I don't know, they're close by.
I don't know what's going on. Sounds like that cat's dying. I'm not a cat guy.
This is the first time I had to actually lay down the law as a dad, and it was not easy.
I think I can't give him his orange juice. It's just a blowout after that, man. It's just like you're running around with a bucket behind him. The craziest colors come out, you know what I mean? You're like, what kind of fucking shade of green is that? I wish I could get my hair that color.
I'll never be as old as Devo. And keep telling myself that.
Can I ask you how old you are? Is that okay?
Yeah.
How old are you?
38. No, 58. I know I had you fooled there for a second.
Oh, it's not too bad. All right, let's go before we get in trouble. Shit. Let's go. God damn it.